Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Welcome to Binghamton First Church of the Nazarene. This is a special day for me because I have a lot of family that's here. I think maybe Maddie wanted to come up and stand with me while I do announcements. You want to come up? Come on.
Yay.
It's always fun to have family around, isn't it? Can you wave at everybody? Thank you. A couple of announcements this morning. Blood drive is Wednesday from 1 to 6. If you haven't gone to sign up for that, and that's something you usually do, you can do that online. That's baby brother. Who is that? Nathaniel. The shirts will soon be here. That was in the announcements earlier. And Michelle has something that she wants to share with us. We have the opportunity to really make an impact on somebody who is not able to be here, and she's going to explain that to you.
Good morning.
Morning.
So it's going to be Rowena's 97th birthday. Her birthday is October 24th. So we as a church want to make this really special for her because she's no longer able to get out. So the goal is 97 cards for Rowena. The way we're going to do this is, if you're a family of two, I'm going to ask that you prepare two cards. So you can go to the dollar store. They have them two for a dollar. You know those cards you get in the mail that somebody wants you to send money back, and you always keep the cards and don't necessarily send money. You can use those. If there's children in your household, have them make a card. To make this even more special and so that Rowena can make some associations, after church this morning and next Sunday, Randy or Kathy Franklin will be out back in the fellowship hall. Oops, nope. We're going to do it in here in the sanctuary against the back wall. They're going to take your picture. And they'll do individual pictures. So each individual card will have your picture. Pastor Wayne's will have his picture in it. And he's going to write a little note in there that says, I'm your pastor.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Mine will say, I am Michelle Cole, daughter of Emma and Byron. Something like that, so she can make an association. So if you have time after church, line up right back there and see. Today it's going to be Kathy taking pictures. We also will be providing a decorated box that will be in the foyer, not this week, obviously. So the sooner we get your pictures taken, the sooner we can get them printed and hand them back to you, put it in your card, and put it in the box. What else have I got here? Any questions, ask me. And next week, I will have a printed handout that will explain all of this in case I was very confusing, which I probably was. So let's make that a goal to get 97 cards for Rowena's 97th birthday. Thanks.
Okay, just one quick question. Okay. So I go in the back today and I get my picture. And I go out this week and I buy a card. And when I come back, if the picture is here, I put it in and then seal it. Don't seal the card up first.
Correct.
All right. I think
then
we're
done. You're going to have to open it and put your picture in.
Just making sure everybody's on the same page, because I would just seal it up. Thank you, Michelle. Every Sunday is a special day. And for many of us, every day is a special day. So I'm going to ask if you would stand with me this morning. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we are so thankful for what you have done on our behalf. As the family of God in this place, we ask that you would help us find ways to share that peace and grace and love that we feel with those in our community. We ask now, Father, that as we worship, that you would be blessed by our praise. We ask for your word to be clear and that you would give us opportunities to encourage and love each other while we're together. As your church, we ask that you may be blessed by our actions as we strive to become more like Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Chronicles 29, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name. Amen.
Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown, your boundless love unfailing, seraphim in ceaseless flight around your glorious throne. They raise their voices day and night in praise to you alone. Alleluia, glory be to our great God. Alleluia.
Before us.
demons run and flee. At the mention of the name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand.
Pray together. Father in heaven, we believe that as we worship in song, our hearts and souls are reminded of who you are. The name that you gave yourself when speaking with Moses, I am that I am. Father, we need to feel your presence day by day. And you are calling us to relationship where that is possible. I ask this morning that on this journey of grace that we are on, you would continue to open our eyes to the truth as we surrender to you. You fill us. Your grace, your peace, your love, you fill us. And as we, on this journey of grace, become more like Christ, we can't help but share your love and your grace and your peace. Father, as your church, we pray that you would fill us today, that you would stand alongside us and encourage us, that you would be our healer, that you would be our foundation, that you would be our protector. We pray for those that need a physical touch from you, for those that are unable to be here this morning, for those that are watching, for those that are far from home. We pray, Father, for friends and family members that are around the globe right now serving their country or serving the church. And we ask, Father, for a sense of your peace as we turn these needs over to you. May the power of your Holy Spirit guide our hearts. And in these moments, may we be able to sense your presence in a new way. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning, I have a special privilege. Since all of our family is here, I am going to pray for Little River, because Allison and Jeremy aren't able to be here that often. But I want to make something very clear. The local church where we worship as an individual family is the place where we dedicate our children. Because I'm father and grandfather, I take a little bit of liberty at this time, but they are going to be with their church family soon, celebrating her dedication. But this morning, I'm going to ask them to come forward because I want to pray over them, and I'm going to ask Tammy if she'll come. We have a something that we want to give them to remember this day. And also, Tammy and I are excited to be able to share this with our church family. The opportunity to recognize that you pray for us as we pray for our family. Well, you're happy today. This is River Ann, all dressed up. Isn't she pretty? Whoa! None of that. None of that. You ready to pray? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, this morning we recognize that family and our church family are very important. And this morning we recognize that blessing of children. You wanted the children to come and sit and be blessed by you. And you've given this opportunity to us to bless one another and family members. This morning, Father, I pray for River, and I ask that you would bless her and keep her and protect her, that you would give her opportunity to know who you are in a real way, and that you will make yourself real to her at a very young age. I pray for Jeremy and Allison and ask that you would give them wisdom beyond their years and the ability to lead by example that she will never be able to escape. We pray, Father, for a blessing on our family and on this little baby in Jesus' name. Amen. If you could do me a favor and all stand for a moment. Allison and Jeremy will be surrounded by their church family, and I just wanted to give them a picture of the people that will be praying for them through us. Thank you so much for being our church family as well. All right, I'm going to give you to Daddy. Yeah. And Tammy has a rose for them to remember this day by. They know that we pray for them, and I wanted them to have the opportunity to see that you pray for them as well. And thank you for sharing this with us this morning. We love you guys. And we love you all as well. You may be seated for the reading of God's Word this morning. Over the past weeks and months, we have been separated, sometimes by choice and sometimes by not our choice, sometimes by sickness and sometimes by distance. But when we're together, I ask that we encourage one another. Let's hear from God's Word together this morning.
This morning's reading is from John 14, verses 1 through 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I'll do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Some Sundays, everything falls into place. Everything works exactly the way it's supposed to. This is not one of those Sundays for me. If I feel a little bit faint and a little bit, I'll sit down. But I forgot to eat breakfast this morning. How many of you ever forget to eat breakfast? Right? It's not just me, right? It's rare, but not always, but every once in a while. What I'd like to do to begin this morning is to pray for us. And really, that's just a cover so I can go down and get my clicker. But, you know, it looks better on camera. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your love. We're grateful to be in the house of God and to be with those who are part of our family. We thank you that we can find encouragement and blessing in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week, we were back in Acts chapter 13. And we talked about the ability of the body of Christ to commission others for ministry. It's our responsibility. We recognize the work of God in someone, and we allow them to represent us as part of the body of Christ. Acts chapter 13, we find Barnabas and Saul. And I always want to be reminded of the fact that until this passage, it's Saul. In the middle of this passage we're going to read, we begin to call him Paul. It has to do with his ease of travel. It has to do with also, I believe, Luke's takes this opportunity to show that Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. That God was filling him with his Spirit for ministry, and that this was just the beginning. Barnabas had come to this place in ministry with the understanding that whatever God wants to do, he's going to do. And I will continue to serve wherever God asks me to. Let's begin. I want to read straight through the passage this morning, and then we'll see what God has for us. Beginning in verse 4 of Acts chapter 13, verse 4. The two of them, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. They traveled through the whole island until they came to Paphos. There they met a Jewish sorcerer and false prophet named Bar-Jesus. We missed a verse, so I'm going to read it out of here. They traveled through, verse 4, the two of them, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. When they arrived in Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues. John was with them as their helper. Verse 6, they traveled through the whole island until they came to Paphos. There they met a Jewish sorcerer. That's kind of an oxymoron, by the way. Jewish sorcerer and false prophet named Bar-Jesus, who was an attendant of the proconsul Sergius Paulus. The proconsul, an intelligent man, sent for Barnabas and Saul because he wanted to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the sorcerer, for that was what his name means, opposed them and tried to turn the proconsul from faith. Then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elymas and said, "You are a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. You are full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. Will you never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord? Now, the hand of the Lord is against you. You are going to be blind, and for a time you will be unable to see the light of the sun." Immediately, mist and darkness came over him, and he groped about seeking for someone to lead him by the hand. When the proconsul saw what had happened, he believed, for he was amazed at the teaching about the Lord. I always like these passages, these narratives. I like the fact that we see some movement, but the passage moves us from one place to another, and it's rather quick. This morning, I want us to consider the narrative for a minute. In the narrative, we have revealed in that first part of the verse the method that is going to be used throughout the rest of the three missionary journeys. They go to the synagogue first. It's obvious these are people that already know Jehovah God through the Old Testament, and this is a better place to start than just going on the street corner and beginning to preach. They go to the synagogue first, and then once the Jews usually will kick them out, they go to everyone else. But usually they have a small group that has started, and they can move out from there and have an impact on the friends and family and other people in that small group. The second in the thing we learn in the narrative is the message. It's just simply put, the word of God. Now, they didn't have a Bible. They didn't have any scrolls. They had them at the synagogue, but it wasn't like Paul was always traveling around with several armfuls of all of the Old Testament with him. Let's be reminded that he was giving the testimony of how God worked in his life, and then he also shared, this is what Jesus taught. It was verbal, but it was leading them to understand, I serve God. Jesus saved me. He set me free from who I was, and now I am a different person, and I want to live like Jesus, the one who came as the Son of God, lived, died, rose again, and is asking the church, us, to share the message of hope. In this narrative, there are some main characters. Barnabas, Saul, who is now going to be called Paul. We have Sergius Paulus, the proconsul, and this Bar-Jesus or Elymas, and the older King James, maybe Magus is what they would call him, or Mogus. This person is very interesting to me. But the focus isn't just on the characters, but it's on how things take place. The main event. It's what we're all really thinking at this point. What really happened? In this passage, we see Barnabas and Saul getting on a boat. They go away, led by the Spirit, to Cyprus. Now, we might just think, okay, sounded like a good place to go. Let's go there. But consider for a moment the cultural ramifications of what they were doing. Did you know that the whole Roman series of worship and religion and gods and the Greek gods and how they kind of morphed them all together? Do you know that it all began on Cyprus? At least that's what they wanted them to believe. Zeus was supposed to be born on Cyprus. And his children were supposed to be born on the islands that are right around. In fact, this is like the center of all of that kind of understanding. So we have this narrative going through. And right at the beginning, the people reading this or hearing it would have made the connection. Oh yeah, Cyprus, that's where Zeus was born. And it would have been just common knowledge for people that were Greek to understand this part of the cultural undertone of the whole passage. Now, why was it so amazing to hear the word of God? What was different about it? I mean, these people worshipped all kinds of gods. Why was it that the sorcerer was so adamant that Sergius Paulus, the proconsul, would not hear the truth? Well, the truth was pretty simple. At the very beginning, there was ever only one God. You see, even the Roman people worshipped or took great pains to understand ancient things. It was the only reason that the Jewish, not nation, but possession, was allowed to use their form of worship and not adopt the Roman form of worship. It was because their God was older and more ancient than all of the gods that came in the Roman world. Sergius Paulus most likely wanted to hear this story because it was something he hadn't heard before. It was new. It was different. It wasn't necessarily exciting yet, but it was so different than anything they had ever heard. In fact, consider, what did you have to do to worship the Roman and Greek gods? Well, let's not say exactly, because some of it was just gross and immoral and crazy, but the gods wanted worship from the mortals. And some of the old ways of understanding the gods was that they created mortals so that they could be served and worshipped. The story of the gospel turns everything on its head. You see, because there was one God, and eventually he sent his only Son. He didn't send his son to whip us into shape and beat on us so that we would obey and worship. No, he sent him to die. Well, wait a minute. Why did he have to die? I mean, he's a God. Why did he have to die? You see, the whole thing was being turned on its head. And Sergius Paulus wanted to hear this, and Satan obviously did not want him to hear it. You see, part of the principles I want us to understand this morning, because the narrative's cool, the story's cool, you know, yay, God wins, yet, you know, boo, Satan loses. But the fact is, there has to be something here that you and I can identify with today that will help us to understand why it is important for us to see, hear the narrative. Barnabas and Saul, now Paul, were led by the Spirit right here. It wasn't by chance, it wasn't by accident. They were led here. And in our lives as followers of Jesus Christ, as we trust on the foundation that there is only one God, and that his desire is to have relationship with us and with the rest of creation, to be reconciled to creation, he sent his son to die so that we might have life, the life we were always intended to live, the one we were created for. In this narrative, we have a couple of things revealed. There are principles that we can see that just jump off the page once we recognize them. The first principle is the cultural obstacle. There are always going to be things that we can't see because we don't necessarily know the culture of the person we're talking to. I grew up in church, so when I talk to church people, it's easy for me to identify with them. There are people who have never been to church. And in these past days, you know, church is the place where you're most easily going to catch COVID if you're not careful. Sorry, at the beginning, that's what they said. And it might be true because we like to hug on each other and shake hands and, you know, do all that kind of stuff. And it's really not a good idea in the current climate. We need to give each other some space and be considerate. But culturally, there are things in people's lives that keep them from hearing the gospel message. Especially when we try to communicate it from our culture without trying to cross the line to their culture. The worship of all kinds of gods was prevalent everywhere except in Judaism. So everywhere they went except the synagogue, people were not going to be able to quite grasp what they were talking about. In fact, at the first hearing, they would have thought, wait a minute, it's just another God. What's the big deal? Until they could make the connection that there's only one God in this system of belief. And he was from before, way before anything else. The second thing that I want us to see, or the principle I want us to understand, is not only are there cultural obstacles in the way, but many times there are spiritual obstacles as well. There are things in place that we can't see or hear or understand. In this passage, there is a sorcerer who is evil. In other words, he has given his life to deceiving others, and specifically Sergius Paulus in this case. For those of you that have watched The Lord of the Rings, I don't even know what his name is. I think it's Snake or something crazy. He's whispering into the King of Rohan's ear, "He's here to deceive you. He's lying. It's not the truth." And constantly. And it had changed the king's total appearance. He was under this man's spell. This is what I picture. A man that has deceived Sergius Paulus into believing things that are completely untrue. There is a spiritual obstacle. And because Paul is filled with the Holy Spirit, he's able to recognize it and confront it head on. Some of us are saying, well, I really don't want to go around, you know, yelling at people, "You're a son of the devil," and... No, that's not the point. You see, he was so filled, so mature in his walk with the Lord, so close to him, that he knew what to do exactly at that moment, the right thing to do. And there is a parallel here. You see, he recognizes that at one point he was on that side too. He wasn't a sorcerer. He was a self-righteous, you know, person who knew the right way, even though he was persecuting the church. And God used blindness to get his attention. You see, the underlying principle isn't that, you know, Sergius Paulus good and Bar Jesus bad. It was they both need to hear this, and the obstacle is spiritual. The truth will come out. God is the God of truth. We've heard that passage, the truth. No, you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. And it is true, but it's the truth about who Jesus is that sets us free. If we understand these principles, that there are obstacles in the way, what is it that we can do to prepare to recognize them and then address them when it's appropriate? 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I think we're in a loop. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 reads the following. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. Verse 4. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. You and I have resources at our disposal, and many times we don't even think to use them. Verse 5 says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. Now, the first part is a wake up. You need to realize there are things at your disposal. The second part is, in order for you to recognize these weapons, you have to do this in your life. I have to put myself in a position to be able to recognize that there is only one God. I want to demolish the arguments by being sure of what God's Word says, by listening to the power of the Holy Spirit. And I want to take captive every thought, everything that comes in, decide whether it's something I need to set aside or it's something that is going to continue to allow me to become more like Christ. You see, our foundation has to be right before our resources are available. Our foundation has to be right and firm before the resources are available. Now, there have been times when I have been put in a position a little bit like Paul and Barnabas. I come and I'm talking with someone and I recognize there's something in the way. What is it is at my disposal in that moment or as I prepare to share a message of hope or just a cup of coffee? It's prayer. Prayer is one of those weapons that is mostly overlooked by the Church of Jesus Christ today because it's something that I do to get something from God. And that's true, but the fact is, for some reason, prayer releases the power of the Holy Spirit to work on the other person's behalf. I pray that God will open the eyes of the person who is listening, that He will open their heart and help them to understand the truth. It's not so much what I say, it's what God wants to communicate with them. And if I am praying that God's will be done in this situation, the prayer is more powerful than anything I can say. You see, many of us want to share our hope and we want to go do something, and that's wonderful. But before you go do something, take advantage of the thing that's most overlooked and pray that God will use this in His timing to bring about His desired result. Relationship with that person. You see, Paul was all prayed up. And when presented with this obstacle, he was able to head on take care of it. And he wasn't just trying to punish this man. I believe he was making that parallel. He was saying, I think that if for a moment you're blind and you understand that I have the ability to connect with the one true God in this way, maybe you will recognize that you can have that relationship too. And Sergius Paulus was there listening and watching, and he needed something to help remove the deception, and God acted. It wasn't just that Paul was ready to speak, it was that God had to act to remove the obstacle. You see, sometimes we put way too much pressure on ourselves. God wants to work and He wants to minister. He wants to bring hope and love and peace. And sometimes we think we have to somehow do this. The principle is Sometimes there are obstacles in the way, and we need to pray and ask God to help us see them. They don't reveal them to us in a way that allows us to act on His behalf. There is no plan B. It's the church of Jesus Christ loving one another and loving the world. It's taking care of one another and reaching out to the world. The church of Jesus Christ in the first century didn't meet in a building like this. They met in each other's homes, and they decided, what are we going to do next so that the message can move out? Well, my sister-in-law, she's having a hard time. She doesn't understand why her kids won't listen, or all of these things. And how can I speak life into that situation? God, we need your help. Let's pray for sister and give her the wisdom she needs. In this passage, we have a narrative that leads us from start to finish. And if we only get the narrative, God wins, Satan loses. If we only see that thing, we don't make a real connection with the journey of grace we are on today. Because in the same way that Barnabas and Saul were prepared to be in the right place at the right time to do what God had asked them to do, you and I have appointments every day. Sometimes they're in our own home. Sometimes they're in our neighborhood. Sometimes they're at our job. And sometimes they're in the grocery store. You and I have divine appointments. We need the Holy Spirit to help us recognize them. My iPhone is not going to remind me, hey, you got an appointment today. Unless I put the appointment in there. In the morning when I get up, I say, God, there are things that you have for me to do today that I don't know anything about yet. But I want your wisdom and I need your grace to recognize them. What is it you have for me? You see, when we are able to help someone find peace, it changes our outlook. It is a blessing. This isn't like going to work and a job. It's, for me, it has become much more an adventure. God, there's something you have for me to do today. I don't know what it is yet. It can be simple as emptying the dishwasher so that Tammy is able to do what she needs to do. That sounds crazy, but it's true. It might be simple as making sure somebody has a cart. When they get out of the car, you recognize they're walking with a cane or they're leaning on their car. They might need that cart. Anything that is an opportunity to know, love, or serve. If there's an appointment for me today, there's an appointment for me tomorrow, I need to spend time finding out what it is God wants me to learn today to prepare me for tomorrow. Sometimes we see Paul and Barnabas, and we see them as people that are larger than life. But the fact is, they spent time with God. When they had access to the scrolls, they read them. They couldn't carry the Bible around with them the way you and I can. Today we can, and we should take advantage of it. We need to spend time in prayer with Him for His purpose and plan and for our friends and family and neighbors, that God will begin to remove the obstacles that might be in the way. If we're not willing to do these simple things, we should not expect the hand of God to be moving. He's going to move whether we ask Him to or not in some situations because His grace is bigger than us, but we have the opportunity to cooperate with the Holy Spirit and bring a sense of peace and hope to the lives of others. The truth is always going to be revealed. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul later writes to the Corinthian church, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Excuse me, the new creation has come, the old is gone, the new is here. You and I are new, and there are others that need to become new. And this is from God, who reconciled us to Himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. that God was reconciling the whole world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, in spite of who we are. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Verse 19. We therefore are Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. How can we apply? We need to pray for understanding. When we pray about the things of the day, when we say, hey, God, I need your help with my homework. You know, I'm really struggling with this area. Help me find somebody that can help me with this, or make sure that I put the time in. Remind me. Or it might be something totally out of the realm of our comfort level. Pray for understanding. Pray for understanding about those we're trying to minister to. Pray for the obstacles that might be in the way, that they might be removed. And pray for the truth to be revealed. Jesus told his disciples, if you will pray in my name, I will do anything that you ask. Many of us hear that and we think, well, it's like the lottery. No, it's not. You see, when we pray in his name, we're using his authority and his purpose and his plan. And when we pray what he has already asked us to do, how can he not answer? The Church of Jesus Christ needs to stand up on the foundation of faith and begin to use the weapons at our disposal, instead of just thinking things are going to continue the way they are day after day. If we continue to act the same way, we will get the same results. We need to change the paradigm. And remember, prayer changes things. As we read through and continue to read through the book of Acts, ask God to reveal to you the principles found in each passage. Next week, we're going to just about finish the chapter 13. If you want to read that this week, that'll be your homework. Next week, the rest of chapter 13. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? Father, I ask now that you would allow your Spirit to move in a new way. I ask that you would help us to recognize the obstacles in our own lives. The things maybe we don't recognize are there. The things that have kept us from hearing your voice on a regular basis. The things that seem to keep us at a distance from you. Help us to see them, Lord, and to take action. We trust in who you are, that you have the best for us, and you want what's best for us, a new life in Christ. On this journey of grace, Father, we ask that we may see you in a new way in the days ahead. And we ask this in Jesus' name.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. His covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul
salvation is found in Him alone. Come sing to the great I Am, our foundation, our rock, the risen Lamb. Come cling to the cornerstone, our salvation is found in Him alone. Come sing to the great I Am.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning, for being in the house of God, and for watching this morning online. I want to say just how much of a privilege it is to be among the people of God on a Sunday. And I know that many of us had the opportunity of having children and grandchildren with us all the time. It's true, you can laugh at them because they're sitting up front and some of the stuff they've been doing during the service. But grandchildren are such a blessing. And I am so grateful for our family and for the family here. With that in mind, I want to thank you for praying for me in these days and for lifting me up. I can tell when you all are praying when I get up to preach. This morning, as we leave, may God bless you and keep you. May you find His Spirit moving in your life in a way that you recognize the obstacles that are there, whether because of our own culture or our own spiritual need. God's desire is for us to recognize Him in a new way. And in the days ahead, our journey of grace will be expanded as we open our hearts to what He has for us next, and as we begin to remove the obstacles that He shows us. May God bless you in the week ahead.